It has traveled across time and space, an energy force unlike any in the universe. It is powerful, intelligent, and it has found the perfect planet to inhabit. Now, in order to survive, it must destroy the one threat to its existence, the virus called man. For today's video, we'll be looking at the comic book story of Virus, written by Chuck Farr. The comic book was released in 1992. A film of the same story was released in January of 1999. And then, the comic book story was released again, but as a graphic novel. There are a few differences between the comic book and the movie, so I'll try to point them out as we go along. The first thing we see in the comic book is the opening scene of a typhoon. We meet the crew aboard the commercial tugboat, the Electra. It's hauling in $10 million worth of cargo. As things get out of control, Averill, who works on the lower deck, tells the captain he will not prep the engines for full throttle. He cares more about the team, when Captain Powell mainly cares about the cargo. They argue about who is doing the right choice here, but the fact is, water is building up on the cargo they are pulling. When it gets too much, it will roll over and pull their ship down with it. Realizing he has no other choice, Captain Powell orders them to cut the cable. By using an acetylene tank, they toss it, ignite it with a flare, and it cuts the cable. They are safe, for now. When morning comes, they assess the damage to the ship. They lost the antennas for the satellite navigation. They have no idea where they are, but they could be 150 miles off course. They come across a lifeboat and a deceased body, but right away, they pick up something on the radar, something big, but it's also not moving. As they head towards the location, they find a Chinese research vessel. It's been assigned to Chinese naval forces. According to law, ships that are abandoned on international waters become derelict. Whoever finds it gets the claim. Before we continue with the comic book story, there are some differences from the film. The first thing is the introduction. A key part of the story occurs during the opening of the movie. A Russian space station is stuck in the path of a giant energy force. It comes out of nowhere. As it hits the station, it connects through its equipment and beams itself down to Earth. The abandoned ship that is found is Russian in the movie, but Chinese in the comic book. And the ship Mr. Powell has in the comic book is the Electra, but in the movie, it's called the Sea Star. Since the comic book story has nothing mentioned about this unknown energy force from space, the reader is left to come up with their own ideas of why this ship is abandoned. As Mr. Averill boards the ship, he finds two deceased bodies on the bridge. He takes a pistol from one of them and goes back to inform his team. Even though everything is shut down, he is ordered to try to bring everything back up. Mr. Averill explores the bottom deck with another shipmate. They discover the ship is nuclear powered. It seems like the crew shut the reactor off when they abandoned the ship. They turn on the power, but it's only enough to turn the lights on. Because Captain Powell wants to salvage the entire ship and its contents, he decides to pull it with his tiny ship. Things go wrong, they suffer a casualty, and Mr. Powell gets injured. Their ship is also damaged and sinking. Not only was the reactor shut off, but the crew on board this ship also smashed every radio and the teletypes were fried. This vessel was used for tracking satellites. They need to find out what happened. Despite everything being destroyed, Malone would try to work with what she has. Perhaps she can send out an SOS with Morse code. Meanwhile, Mr. Averill goes to find bandages and medicine for Captain Powell. As Miss Foster reaches the mission control room, her face appears on the TV monitors and is confronted by something very strange. This thing is mechanical with wings, but also appears organic in some way. Mr. Averill rushes in and smashes the thing with an axe. They have a closer look at it, and they discover it's got gyros, electric motors, and a circuit board. The power source is probably from the body parts of the deceased. Somebody or something stayed behind. The team finds out that the lifeboats were cut and set loose, but who did this? The blame is put on a team member, but he's innocent. A previous incident involved the anchor that smashed through their boat. It just dropped on its own. This scene was expanded upon in the movie. The virus takes control of the ship's computers and drops the anchor on their boat. It's trying to keep them on the ship. Moments later, a plane flies by, but it's not here to rescue them. It opens fire on the ship, trying to destroy it. But the microwave dishes start operating on their own, and it deflects the missiles. The team realizes that things got weird after they turned the power on, so their task now is to cut the circuit breakers. Appiah and Richie are sent down below to throw every bus connector they can find. As they have one more connector left, Richie stays behind to drink a bottle he finds. He then hears a noise and goes in the hallway, only to meet up with something. It's a combination of robotic and organic parts. Appiah ends up saving him by turning on the firebox. Richie is so distressed and shook up, he can barely comprehend what he saw. He just says, "That goddamn thing came after me. It was like a robot. It has eyes. Real eyes. It was coming after me." As they examine the hallway where this occurred, they discover that something is tapping into the main computer buses. Whatever this thing is, it needs the ship's power to operate. They follow the slime trail even further down below, hoping to cut the power at the source. But when they reach the generator room, they find out something big has took the generator away. But there are more problems. Miss Foster explains the circuits came back on 5 minutes ago. First, the forward part of the ship, then the engineering spaces. The whole ship is powered up again, not by the generator, but by the nuclear reactor. As Captain Powell recovered from his injury, he takes command and orders his team to bring the ship to the nearest port. The prospect of monetary gain is too much to pass up. Four other crew members join him, while Miss Foster and Mr. Averill disagree. Even though they patched up the hull from the missile attack, he knows the ship won't make it. The only option they have is to shut down the engines, but Averill knows something is down there. They locate a TV room and play a recorded tape. It goes over some details of what happened on board the ship. On May 7th, research scientists from the People's Republic succeeded in establishing a deep space communication link with an extraterrestrial intelligence. Two-way communication was established at 1405 Zulu Mean Time with a VLF radio source in the Pleiades system. The first communication consisting of 20,000 megabytes of binary code is now being deciphered by the ship's onboard computers. May 7th was 2 days before they found this ship, when they were caught in a typhoon. Whatever happened on board must have been worse if they stayed, so crew members might have abandoned the ship during the typhoon. Perhaps the binary code they put into their computer was not a signal of communication, but in fact, maybe a code for a virus. It seems like the Chinese are aware of what happened, so they're trying to sink the ship. They might come back to finish the job. In the movie, this scene is different. The crew uses a computer to communicate with this thing or entity within the computer system. It speaks back by saying this, "I am aware. Life form analysis complete. Species is destructive, invasive, noxious, harmful to the body of the whole. You are virus." When they ask what it wants, it gives out a list, all attached to an optic nerve. It simply wants humans as spare parts to create its own cyborg body. Meanwhile, Mr. Averill and Miss Foster locate the propeller room. If they reduce the amount of gears, the propeller won't turn. If that doesn't function, then they won't move. Back on the bridge, they notice the ship is slowing down, so Richie is sent to find the captain. But upon locating him, we see that Captain Powell and Malone are now different. As Captain Powell approaches the bridge, Richie realizes what happened to Captain Powell. He was transformed into a cyborg. He attacks Hooker and Richie until Averill shows up. By using a pistol, the bullets only seem to slow Powell down a bit. So Averill grabs an axe and slashes at Powell over and over until he stops moving. In the movie version, Captain Everton talks to the entity through a computer. He agrees to help it in exchange for one thing. Everton would appear later on the bridge, but he's now a cyborg like the others. This version of the captain does not last long in the story. But things don't end here. Malone, who is now a cyborg as well, comes smashing through the wall. She's not here to fight. She merely recovers the body of Powell. The survivors would then devise another plan. By using a Chinese to English dictionary, they read over the ship's blueprints and locate a weapons room. Now armed with more firepower, they can fight back. And maybe they could survive this encounter. Before they can leave the room, they are attacked by another cyborg. They unload their weapons on it, but it's not enough. So Avril would toss a grenade, and the explosion only slows it down. Malone is spotted going to the satellite. If she fixes the uplink, they can transmit their data to any computer in the world. They quickly get rid of Malone, and she comes falling down from the satellite. Even though the propellers were damaged by Avril, the virus is self-aware of what's going on. It even tries to build its own plane to escape, but that is dealt with shortly after. And things get even more interesting. Not only was that just a plane, that vehicle was also part cyborg in some way, just like the others. They pour oil on the floor, and they defend a hallway. The previous enemy finds them again, so they light it on fire, hoping it works. You can't just shoot them. You have got to get rid of every piece. During this encounter, Richie was sent to gather wood for the barricade, but has not returned. We then hear his voice in the distance. Help me. Please, somebody. Help. They follow his voice, but cautiously. As they go deeper into the darkness, they find Richie, but it's too late. He's already gone. His head was used by one of the cyborgs. Richie's voice was used to lure them into a trap. The group runs back through a doorway and seals it, but the cyborg follows them. They rig a few grenades and it explodes as the cyborg breaks through the door. Despite their attempts of disabling the ship's movement, the virus still manages to get the engines fixed. They are now headed for Oahu, Hawaii. If it reaches the port, it can spread much faster. They have to do something. As they search around the ship, they come across a factory. This is where the cyborgs are created. They are then attacked by another enemy once again, but this time use water to slow it down. They flooded the bilge and main passageway with water. The virus would have to divert power from the engine room to pump out the water. This would slow the ship's movement speed and the cyborgs being functional, a perfect time to move around. As they explore the ship some more, they come across the missile that hit the ship. It turns out it never exploded, and the damage was caused by burning fuel and kinetic shock. They still have a warhead they can use. If they can lure the virus to the front of the ship, the detonation might not be so damaging, so they could still use the ship to escape if this works. But all they need now is bait. Mr. Avril volunteers to get the cyborg's attention. He ventures down in the lower deck, past the flooded hallway, but then Appiah shows up to help him. It doesn't take long until they are tracked down by something new. Another cyborg tears through the floor. It appears much larger than the others and more heavily armored. They toss a grenade at it, but it's not that effective. Appiah stays behind to shoot it, but gets eliminated quickly. In the movie, the largest cyborg is called Goliath. As Mr. Avril runs up the stairs, he gives the signal to blow the warhead. They had little time to prepare, and the damage tears the ship in half, with both pieces starting to sink. The giant cyborg emerges from the smoke and fire. It sees the survivors and jumps towards them, but it doesn't reach the distance it planned. It falls into the water and sinks, only to reappear from underneath them. Two men try to fight back, but they get overpowered by the cyborg. Miss Foster releases the anchor and its heavy weight smashes through it and pushes its remains into the open waters. The movie version has the Goliath being destroyed within the ship when it explodes. With only two survivors left and no ships in the area, they might not last more than 2 days, unless the sharks get them. They are later saved by helicopters from Auckland. They picked up their SOS 36 hours ago, but other ships are also looking for that Chinese vessel. The ending in the comic book shows a floppy disk still in the ocean. This could be a way of leaving it open for a sequel, but the problem here is that a floppy disk would not be able to hold 20 gigabytes of alien AI data. But then again, this is just a story, so anything can happen. The movie version of the Russian ship is called the Academic Vladislav Volkov. It was in fact a retired United States Navy transport ship, the USNS General Hoyt Vandenberg. And a video game was made in 1999 for the PlayStation 1 console. The title was Virus, It Is Aware, which is taken from the movie trailer. The virus is now referred to as Evil. While the comic book and movie took place in open waters, the video game story had the ship making it to the port. This was a decision the developers took because they thought a ship on the open sea was too limited. And they also released action figures. They were made by the Resource Company. They were meant to advertise the movie. The script was sold to Dark Horse Comics because Chuck Farrer thought a movie adaptation could not replicate all the special effects required for the story, but they pulled it off, and a lot of work and dedication went into the movie. The names of some characters were changed from the comic book to the film, and despite their minor differences, they both delivered a fairly similar story. So that covers the comic book story of Virus. If you enjoyed this video, leave a like rating on it. I've covered a lot of franchises over the past few years, so check out my lore and history playlist. You might find something else to watch. If you want to see more content like this, then subscribe to my channel and turn on notifications. This way, you get notified when I upload a video. Thanks for watching and supporting my channel. This is Carlos or Acid Glow, and I'll see you next time.